So I then began working on tobacco mosaic virus. And as you know, we published a map of 10 angstroms by 1971, by which time Ken Holmes had left to go to Germany. But
there was a row, wasn't there, over TMV and Pirie?
Oh, yes, yes. What happened was that we used to get our supplies, of tobacco mosaic virus from Pirie, who was the virologist at Rothamstead.
Yes.
And Rosalind once published a paper to say that tobacco mosaic virus was a long rod of 6,000 angstroms long, and which was had been seen by Robley Williams. And it contained, well, she didn't know the number of number of bases that contained in the RNA. But the so Pirie took exception to this, and he stopped sending us material. He said, as far as he's concerned, tobacco mosaic virus is a collection of rods of different sizes, and all the preparations are infectious. You don't have to have the infectious particle. Isn't necessary, the 6,000 angstrom, the long unbroken rod. And Pirie was an interesting man, very clever man, one of these clever people who they were so clever they get drive themselves into false conclusions. I remember at the time in 1950, to go back a bit, when I was in the Cavendish, he wrote an article in Penguin Science News, which most of the sort of budding scientists read at the time. This is NW Pirie, who'd been lecturer in Cambridge, very influential, very clever man, influential and sort of charismatic, very keen with a sort of fork. Like he went to Rothamsted. He was also sort of very left wing like Bernal. But the he wrote an article and said, just imagine a protein. See, nobody had worked out the structure of a protein. And he questioned whether a protein had a structure, a definite structure. He pointed out that if you had a three-dimensional structure of a protein and you replaced a valine by an isoleucine, it wouldn't make any difference. Indeed, that's true generally. These are just silent mutations or silent changes,
yes.
Polymorphisms as they're called.
Yes.
But of course, he didn't know about sickle cell haemoglobin. If you change a valine to a glutamine, the whole thing it's a disease gene, gives you sickle cell anemia.
But he wasn't persuaded by Bernal's photographs going out to 2 angstroms or whatever.
No, no, that was a regular. No, he wasn't. He was, he was, as I've said, he was one of these guys who was a bit too clever is not the right word, too firm in his opinion. He never thought he could be wrong, which is one of the things you have to learn.
There were serious consequences about on the financial situation from that.
He
was on the ARC.
Yes, ARC.
Yeah.
So, so in the end, the ARC grant began to looked as if it was going to end.
Yes.
And Rosalind went to see Sir William Slater, who was the head of the Agricultural Research Council. And he patronized her. He said, oh, well, we have an X-ray set in Sheffield. You have to move to Sheffield. We'll fix you up there. And no understanding at all. And I think partly because she was a woman, in those days, there were people who didn't take women scientists very seriously. It was very different. And Dorothy Hodgkin could charm her way through anybody, but Rosalind wasn't like that. So Rosalind was quite fierce, as you know.
Yes.
But she phoned me up almost in tears to say there's going to be no renewal of the grant. So we didn't know what to do. I had my own fellowship, but this was going to run out. And so to the rescue came Robley Williams from Berkeley. He was a distinguished electron microscopist, and he came from Berkeley, the famous virus lab. And he was visiting Cambridge, working Kenneth Smith's lab for a year. And he suggested we apply for a grant to the American, the US National Institutes of Health.
Yes.
And none of us knew we could get a grant from an American body. And he said, well, you can if you're working on something which nobody in the States is doing. So we applied to the NIH. And by this time, I can't remember whether we already started to work on spherical viruses. I think we had. But the main thing was NIH.
Yes.
And Robley Williams. So we applied. Rosalind was the principal investigator, and I was the co-investigator. And it was very businesslike. Robley Williams came again on a visit, and he was made a site. I didn't know what a site visit was. He came on a site visit. He said to him, he said to us, if you get a centrifuge, because we didn't have a centrifuge to prepare the virus, where will you put it? And he went out, and who will you do this, and how will you do that? It was all very businesslike, because we answered him. Yes. And we got the grant. Now, the grant was for £10,000 a year for 3 years. That's £30,000.
Yes.
Now, nobody had ever got any grant of this size at Birkbeck before, not even Bernal or anything. So the Andrew Booth, who was on the council, told us later, if he misunderstood, he thought it was £10,000 for the whole 3 years. And if he had heard it, if he had realized it was £10,000 a year, he would have voted against it because he thought this would give an undue advantage to certain people in the in the college. His idea was, you know, the sort of British defeatist that you have to share your misery. And the it was quite a... and then, of course, we had to, our salaries had to come from the grant as well.
Yes.
So Sir John Lockwood, who was the master of Birkbeck, beat us down, Rosalind and myself, to the lowest possible level.
Yes.
And I remember what he said. You have to work for the love of the subject, the love of the subject. We were living in a right at the top of an attic flat in Chalk Farm and so on. We had one small child by this time.
Yes.
So anyway, but it did, that grant did save us and enabled to transfer the, and we were able to, we bought another X-ray set, I can't remember. So that was a great change.